Hey guys, and welcome back to Oxygen Not Included, Clay's amazing space colony simulator extraordinaire. My name is Twitchy, and the quality of life upgrade has landed. Honestly though, all they've done is rearrange the tech tree and add a few like nice things to put around for your duplicates. So I'm not going to go into too much of detail for that. You'll see things happen in the background that kind of take effect from that. So last time we spent most of our time working on the algae distillery because we want to start exploring out and around this great rock that I have called Twitchy's Tremendous Trojans, a small planetoid filled with my patrons as a duplicates. As well as going around and doing the algae distillery, we also drained all the water that was easily available around the base into this one great big tank here. And we need to seal that up because I want to go exploring, and if we're going to go exploring, we're going to drag germs into the base. And if I'm going to drag germs into the base, I don't want it getting into my main water supply. If slime lung gets into our main water supply, I think we are done for. I know specifically if food poisoning gets into our main water supply, we are really done for because that just will not go. So we've got duplicates going around and tidying up. I feel like we need to get this airlock in a fair state of repair. We need to tidy up the floor. We need to get some tiles put down, maybe seal up the bit above us. But you can see almost everybody is taken up with the job of tidying this place up because I just want to get my water tank cleaned, get the floor clear and no building materials on the bottom. Because if we do it now, we know everyone's clean. If we do it at random points when we need the items, who knows whether people are clean or not. During all of this, I am massively cognizant of my algae readout on the top right there. You can see there is a little bit of my inventory that I have expanded out. That is my algae. I have got 15 tons. Now that sounds like a fair bit, but if you consider that is the only thing I've got making oxygen at the moment, then I'm a little bit worried about that. So that's the main reason that I want to go, well, one of the many reasons that I want to go exploring to the left. The other one, of course, just to have a look around. Go and see if we can find any geysers anywhere, any like past builds from future civilizations that seem to be scattered around this rock, but no one really explains why or how they got there. There are logs in computers and stuff like that. I don't think I've ever actually collected enough of them together to get a full idea of what's going on, but they all just seem like general job memos. So anyway, nighttime falls again and everything is going well. The duplicates are sleeping sound, and this is one of the few times that I get to check, make sure that everybody is indeed sleeping well. You can see that I've built some storage compactors at the top left there. That is because that particular floor is covered in floor detritus, and I would like to get that done. We are very close to actually having my water tank completely sealed up. I want to go for a double door affair, and I don't just mean two doors as I've done there, but I want two layers of those two doors just to make sure that nothing can actually drop through the airlock, because I've got a feeling airlock is going to be one of the more at-risk areas when it comes to dirt and germs and stuff like that. It's about this time that I realized that my initial plannings of where to put this airlock are kind of a little bit wrong. What I actually wanted to do was explore this swamp biome, and my airlock is in line with the hot biome underneath. Now, thankfully, they're not too far removed from each other, just a single, there's three layers of abyssalite, but just a single seam of abyssalite but separates the two. So it shouldn't be too hard to get my guys up there. And we are going to follow Zedtech for the next couple of days or so, as he's the man who does all the digging, and if anything new is going to be explored, we generally have to dig our way to there. We've got a little bit of a problem right now because people are pinned in with sand, but what do you know, when there's no other option, they will dig their ways out of there. I spot that there is a little bit of algae underneath, and I think Zed is probably the man to deal with that, but no, what do you know, he has to go off on a trip somewhere. Now this is one of the things that confuses me the most. Despite the fact that I have gone through and changed all the priorities, ups and downed people to try and make it so that they only really have one job, every now and then something else will just come along and go, no, I'm a much higher priority job. And as like Zedtech is literally the man for the digging, I find that very confusing. But if he's doing things such as carrying dirt around or algae, I suppose we can let him off that. The resupply jobs are quite important. So once again, another daytime goes down and nighttime hits us. And once again, I'm forced to ask the question whether my duplicates have enough time at night, whether the evening time gives them enough time to eat all their food and deal with all their business and stuff like that. You just watched me change a Mad Frank and Sir Steve's job priorities from operation to research, because I want to start getting the electrolyzer down. And there's also a few other things that I want, things such as a temperature sensor, a germ sensor. With those comes the need to refine some metals, because it turns out you can only use refined metals in the automation layer. So, well, at least for the items that go on the automation layer. You guys know what I mean. So I've talked about the electrolyzer and I've talked about my shortening levels of algae. The space that I'm currently emptying out on the right hand side of your screen next to the research, this area here, it's probably going to end up being an oxygen production station. We're going to put a few pipes going up into there as the water is literally just underneath, and we can ship some electrolyzers, get the whole gas pressure self-sorting system where we have hydrogen and oxygen sinking in two different manners. Hydrogen likes to float, oxygen likes to sink down. We can put some tiles down to take advantage of that and end up with a lovely little self-filtering system. I put down a few more storage compactors just because it's always nice to have that. And then for some reason, I forget my number one rule of only sticking with one job at any one time and start putting down a sleet wheat farm. I just get carried away. I'm like, yes, this is definitely something I need to do now. We have practically done the airlock, but my guys hadn't actually really even cracked into the swamp biome, the slime and algae biome that is on the left-hand side. And I really should have left them to do that. I should have upped the priorities of those jobs over there so that we could get everyone involved in the same place. And it's just a lot easier. It stops people having to run from one side of the rock to the other to get the jobs done that I have assigned for them. And if they just spend all their time in one place, they get the jobs done quicker because they're not running around everywhere, right? So another day is done, and mostly I'm happy with the progress that's been going on here. We've managed to get the airlock dug, the little area for any future projects dug, and of course the beginnings of the sleet wheat done. Next I want to start working on brute force reinforcement. Brute force reinforcement sounds like a good one though. Clay, you can have that for free. But yeah, brute force refinement, so that we can take some of our copper or gold ore and refine it down to actual copper or gold for advanced technologies. And I was kind of hoping Zed would just kind of get back on with the sleet wheat, but no, he goes over to the left first to help dig with the new airlock, and I think that's a great idea. But then no, suddenly he's back over to this side for the sleet wheat, which is fine. I've got no problems with that, but I wish he would stick to one job or the other. One thing that I also wish is that these guys would carry on working in that room over there. And I notice that the reason that they're not is because there's no oxygen, that in the room over there being obviously this one where the sleet wheat is being made. So my first plan is to throw down a deoxygenizer where it takes the oxygen out of the algae and put down a bunch of wires and stuff like that. But you know, that gets a little over the top when you're putting down tiles into abyssalite. So we're watching Brum at the moment just to watch what's going on around the base more than anything. Brum has got a few jobs going on trying to fix up the insulation and stuff like that. But I have noticed that we've got a farmhand doing the research, and that is not the order that I wanted to do in. So I have gone round and reordered the priorities. Hopefully that is going to be the winning formula there, but we'll just have to wait and see. So it's about here that I realized that maybe the deoxygenator is not the best choice to go for here. Not only because of they having to rip up the tiles underneath and do stuff like that, but also we would just end up over pressurizing the area. We'd have carbon dioxide and oxygen both fighting for a space. So maybe the better idea is to put down an algae terrarium. I think that's probably a much smarter idea. We haven't got any lights or anything like that down here, so it should just churn over slowly all unto itself. And because people aren't going to be down that way that often, only to look after the farm, though, they should be able to keep the carbon dioxide levels down low. I also put a door in to seal up the upper space, because obviously we would lose it all to the upper chambers if I just left it. So I did a sneaky little priority rejuggle there to make sure that everyone gets onto the insulation tires on the left. And it turns out other people will have other jobs that are just as important. Things like keeping the power running, keeping the food going. Well, the one thing, talking about all the priorities, another three knows where his job is at. He just makes sure he sits on the cook station whenever the job is available. Now, obviously, sometimes that job's not available, and he goes around and helps out with the other jobs as any a good and wholesome duplicate wood. So we finally got the rock granulizer, and I have a quick think around where I'm going to place it. Do I put it down here? Do I put it up there? But I eventually put it into this space next to the research lab, and I'm fine with that. We can live with that. I have a quick read through the requirements, decide that it's not going to completely overwhelm my power grid when I hook it up. But also, we managed to just get some of the automation, and I would like to try and fix that at some point as well. But we're going to watch this algae terrarium get put into place and make sure that everything is all working over here, that we can just ignore everyone and watch people disappear up ladders to go and get oxygen. That's very crazy. I wasn't really expecting that as a side effect, or at least I was, but I wasn't expecting to see that right now, because I was expecting those to get put into place first. And I'm wondering when I'm actually going to fill that gap there. You can see the central ladder has got a space that I have cleared out for a tile or a door or something to encapsulate that little area. But no, it turns out we're just going to look at it. It's going to be a glaring hole for us. There we go. Finally, the door has been put in place and my duplicates can come around and encapsulate that area so the oxygen can stay there. Brum doing a little bit of a dance there. I tried to save him, but he actually did manage to sort out his pathing and find the actual oxygen. I assume what was going on is he was trying to chase down a floating patch of oxygen and he was having to rechange the end point of his path quite often. So another night falls down. Everyone seems to be doing all right, apart from Shadow over there, who is up all night. We need to try and sort that out. Literally went to bed 1 hour, one segment before the day was over. We put a bit of wire going around the outside of that little hump there. That's mainly just so people can get to all the bits. If I had just gone straight across where the little hump exists, which is there to make sure all the storage compactors line up, that we wouldn't have been able to put that last bit in there. It's beautiful. I'm waiting for my water to drain out of this, what was originally primary water tank, but now a secondary water tank. I have turned off the pump in the primary water tank, as you can see, and I'm waiting for the toilet, shower, and sink use. I suppose I don't have any showers, but toilet and sink use to start eating all of the water up for me, and that'll all disappear, and that will be great. I might end up actually having to pump it out at some point. We'll see about that. We're gonna follow another three around a little bit because I was really interested in what he was doing. I've noticed that we followed a few people around, but we've not really followed another three around at all, and that's because he's just kind of like the base man, you know. He's the guy going around and doing all the important background jobs. He's making sure that the power runs up high, he's making sure that we've got enough food to take care of the base. It's just he's the solid man, you know. He's totally solid. Alright, so the rock granulizer has been made, it has been wired up, and now I have set up some jobs. So we just gotta wait for the duplicates to come along, and there goes a Dead Tech, and Sir Steve delivers a few bits of ore, and Sir Steve hits that button and gets the gold being a process. There it is, a beautiful, a wonderful, and amazing stuff. So with that, we can make some sensors, and the first thing I'm gonna do is drop a thermosensor in the water and connect it to the space heater. This just means that when eventually the water reaches, I'm gonna go 45, that's currently at 44, but I'm gonna set it to 45. When it reaches that, it will turn the space heater off so that we're not overcooking the area. I'm mostly worried about the space heater melting itself. This is something that I have seen other bits of heat equipment do, so I'm worried that that will also do it. Starting to put down the sleet wheat now, feeling pretty good about that. The one thing that I do notice is that it needs regular water irrigation. Now, I would like to just pump some water in. That would make sense, right? But if I pump water into a minus 33 degree biome, we are going to have many, many troubles with ice inside water pipes. And this game does not like having ice inside water pipes. Much like real life, actually. If you end up with a bunch of ice inside your water pipe, you're going to have a hard time trying to sort that out. Having a quick look through the furniture, because I want to put a new picture up for another three. He stands there a lot, and it turns out he could do with some nice luxuries. But no! The quality of life upgrade has moved it to a much further on piece of technology. So that's fine. We got a few paintings for free, if you will. And we decided that we actually need a little bit more room in the tank there than where I had originally put that sensor. I would like to be able to put a germ sensor right next to the pump, so obviously the thermosensor is going to have to be one further away. No problem at all. Just something that I was glad that I caught before I put everything in. Brum did come along to put the sensor in, but oh, it gets hot, it gets fausty in there, not enough oxygen to go around, so he needs to break out every now and then. Finally set the actual temperature onto the thermosensor to tell it what temperature we want to be at, and that should be a totally automated system now. So whilst we've got the sleet wheat farm on the go, I once again start the next job of deciding that I want to completely encase the hot water tank in insulative tiles. Thankfully, almost all of this can be done from the outside. In fact, I think everything can be done from the outside, so that's going to be pretty good. I also want to try and seal off the bit with the space heater inside it, and then maybe try and figure out a way of flooding that with hydrogen, so because hydrogen is the most conductive of thermal gases, it turns out. And then it'll be a nice little sealed-in system. Now that I think doubly hard about it. I would have actually have liked to have put some hydrogen flowing up and around it and maybe having a little bit of airflow going so that we're constantly warming up new hydrogen that comes across and warms up the water. That would have been great, but turns out, no, that's not what we did. So I mentioned earlier that the top left had a floor that was covered in detritus that would not just get picked up. I've now given them a much higher priority on that job, getting that all picked up, so that's pretty good. And I forgot that when replacing one tile for another, some water would leak out. Thankfully, that one tile on the left that was under water level is the only one that's going to leak. This one on the right that Brom started doing, but here comes Captain Subs to finish off, is nicely enclosed by all its brethren around it. So that's managed to keep all the water nice and safe. Brilliant. So we're going to watch this for a little while. Brom is struggling. There's a lot of carbon dioxide around here, and I didn't quite realise how bad it was at the time. But now that I'm becoming more aware, I might try and do something, maybe get some more algae terrarium down there, something like that. A little bit worried about how hot it might be. Maybe it'll be using more water. I don't know if the temperature actually has any effect on the algae terrarium at all whatsoever. But this is all in kind of preparation for sealing this off even more from the base. Whilst it is in a hot biome and heating up a hot biome isn't too much of a bother, I still am going hotter than the ambient of the hot biome. So I would just like to try and keep that contained if I can. Runaway heat is a serious problem. It really, really is. One of the great things about recording these beforehand and then doing my post voiceover like this is I get to have a bit of an overview, in the same way that you guys watching the video afterwards get to have an overview. And I have noticed here that people walking back and forth to put water into the plants is becoming a bit of an issue. Into the sleet wheat is becoming a bit of an issue. Now, as I've already pointed out, we cannot pump water straight into the farm tiles because obviously this will freeze the water in the pipes. Ice in pipes is bad things. But this also means we can't have standing water in there to be able to like pump some water with the pump machine that we've got down the bottom. So I'm going to have to set up a little sink, if you will, somewhere in one of the warmer biomes to try and move water in. Maybe put it into that airlock that we have there. I think that would actually work out quite well. If we have a too wide gap, put the water pump in there, have a small, literally one tile, two tile drop for the water to be in. That should work out a-okay. Unfortunately, we're not going to watch that happen because, like I say, I've only just got the overview that comes from watching afterwards. And speaking of overview, we get to have a look at how everyone is running around the base at the moment. I'm watching to see if that the operators are operating, or at least the research people are operating, making sure that Captain Subs is the man going around doing the delivery, or maybe even Trouticus himself. ZTech, not so interested in the digging at the moment. I'm not entirely sure why. And we're going to start the textile production. I was looking for it so that we could have the canvases and start making painters again, but also you get things like the textile loom and also carpeted tiles, a new feature with the quality of life upgrade that I'm not sure entirely how great it is. So I noticed that these guys were not digging the exploratory tunnel to the left, so I pumped up the priority of that. And you can also see that I've kind of widened out the digging area. This is a tip that I picked up three or four upgrades ago. This enables a lot of duplicates to kind of get at the same work face, and this will put everyone all together so that it can do the job quicker without them having to run around and find other items and stuff like that. And that way people like ZTech can just carry on digging whilst you have Captain Subs doing the delivery and building everything. And I think that's Brom there working on the outside wall of the of whatever this actual room is going to be. I started off thinking that it was going to be an electrolytic room where we can make some oxygen and stuff like that. I'm not so sure now whether it's going to be there or this one with the metal refinery in it or what. Or maybe we'll actually pump our oxygen production off to a cooler place, because that would be pretty cool. One thing that I found out about the algae terrariums whilst trying to find out if temperature actually affects them at all is, one, no, temperature does not affect them at all, but two, the oxygen from them actually comes out at 30 degrees, which is classed as a little bit warm for what the duplicants like. So having a oxygen source in a colder area might actually work out well for keeping the temperature down in my base. I also literally, between voice recordings whilst doing this episode here, have found out the efficiency ratio, shall we say, of the water use between algae terrariums and the electrolyzer. And whilst the algae terrariums are pretty good at dealing with the carbon and using the algae up at not too massive a rate, compared to the water, that's where the inefficiency comes in. So maybe we will actually be working towards the electrolyzer at some point very soon. So we've been following Captain Subs here for a little while. I like to follow Subs or Shrouticus around because they are the ones that cover a lot of distance in the base. Mainly they are the delivery people. Subs is actually more about building than about delivery, but that is his like background job, if you will. If there's no digging to do, no building to do, then he will do the delivery. And you may have saw that right there. That was a natural gas geyser. Yes, indeed. This was the very thing that I was exploring for. I am so happy that it is within a screen's distance from my base. I was kind of getting a little bit worried that we might end up actually having it like all the way over the other side of the map, and that would be very awkward for getting the power sorted. But as it's so close, we're going to do very well. Of course, natural gas, we can burn in a natural gas generator. It produces like carbon dioxide and polluted water. Not a big problem. We already know how to deal with these things, and a buttload of energy, which is what we are after. Though I did notice that we're getting a little bit of polluted oxygen sort of like drifting its way down this ladder in towards the base. So I've put down a few deoxygenators are the first oxygenation piece that we have access to. Those things on the right, the screen passed far too quick there. With the polluted oxygen also comes slime lung. So I got a little bit worried about that. I was like, oh wait, hang about, I have got no sinks in my airlock here, and that is something we need to make sure. I'm going to start off by putting a temporary one down because I'm not sure whether this airlock is even going to live here or whether it's going to get moved up to another level. But the next thing we need to do, or at least the next thing that Shrouticus and Subs need to do, is start moving all the slime that we have over towards our algae distillery, because, you know, that's what we do with slime. We don't want to watch the slime all just evaporate into polluted oxygen. No, we want to turn that into algae because it's nice and stable. Slime evaporates, algae stable. And you can see that I'm going around here and selectively sweeping in some sort of vain hope that the slime will end up being put inside the algae terrarium, algae distillery. And I think that actually works out quite well for us. We're digging our way up here because obviously we need to get to the natural gas geyser up there. But you can see top right, or at least you could have seen top right, that I'm beginning to also build another airlock, because it's going to be very important that we can get our dudes from the airlock to the generators pretty quickly, at least whilst we're starting up, because we're going to need a little bit of seed energy to get everything running, and that's where that will be. So looking at the inventory on the top right, you can watch the numbers of slime drop down and the amount of algae go up. The balance between the two seems very interesting, but that is because if you have a look, we are recording slime in kilograms, whereas we're doing algae in tons, so that's why those numbers are so wide apart. Constantly checking my temperatures here, making sure that we're not actually having any temperature leak into the base. And the good thing that I notice is because we kept the base at such a high pressure compared to everywhere else, every time the airlock doors open, a bit of cold escapes as opposed to heat coming in, which I'm all right with. One thing I'm not so all right with is the building requirements for the germ sensor. Turns out I need a little bit of plastic for that. I suppose actually I am kind of all right with it, but it means we're going to have to put it off for a couple of episodes until we can dig down to the plastics, to the oil, so that we can start our plastic generation there. Having a look at the sleep wheat farm, it's all working out a-okay for us. It does take a little bit of time for people to deliver water over there, but we are making some serious sleep wheat. The one thing that I do have a little bit of trouble with is duplicants will walk in there, they will radiate a little bit of heat, and then the polluted ice that is around them will start melting. This is something that I need to address at some point, but right now it's not the biggest problem. Water is still got a little bit of food poisoning in it. Great, perfect. That's almost exactly what we set it up to deal with. And now these guys come along and start sweeping, but almost immediately the water will drip. I don't actually manage to catch it on footage at any time, but next time we go look, there will be some water on there, and I'm not sure where it came from. Actually, my little theory is, and I'm not sure whether this actually holds up true or not, so don't quote me on it, but my theory is the bottles of polluted water actually freeze back into polluted ice, and then when the duplicants go and walk over the farm, they will then melt them again with their body heat. I think, look, see, it's happened, and I don't know where. I didn't even see a tile melt or anything like that. It could very well. If someone wants to go through and count the bottles to see whether that is true or not, I will be very, very grateful. In the past few moments, whilst we've been speaking, you can see that the textile working research has come in. This enables us to put down a whole bunch of canvases in the mess hall, make everyone feel super nice about going to eat some food. I also want to put some in the kitchen, but I need to rework the kitchen. At the moment, we've only got the microbe musher, which you can only really deal with lice loaf. And now that we have sleet wheat, I need to have a grill so we can make some frost buns and get everyone eating some very, very, very nice food. But with the dawning of a new day, I'm going to have to say thank you very much for joining me for this adventure, ladies and gentlemen. Gentlemen, I will see you next time when we're going to work on the power plant for that natural gas geyser, and maybe we'll start digging down looking for oil, because that is definitely one of our new priorities moving forward from here. But I will see you then when we're going to do that. Bye!